All right, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And happy Father's Day to all the fathers. You're welcome. And I'm not going to be here, so just to say, Nathaniel's going to take over after me. So let's pray before the children and young people come to lead our service. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful day. To reflect, to think about fathers, to thank you for fathers in our lives. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with us in our service, guide our children, our young people, as they lead us in worship. We pray that you will grant us grace to receive from you what you have in store for us today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Welcome to our Father's Day service. Father's Day gives us the opportunity to show our appreciation for our fathers and for all men who have cared for us, and to thank both of them. We can also remember that Jesus himself grew up in a normal family, and so understands both the joys and the stresses of living with our people. We are the family of God, and we must thank him for the amazing love he has for us, his family. And remember that God wants us to love one another. Father's Day was founded in Spokane, Washington at the YMCA in 1910 by Sonoris Smart Dot, who was born in Arkansas. Its first celebration was in the Spokane YMCA on June 19, 1910. Her father, the Civil War veteran William Jackson Smart, was a single parent who raised his six children. The tradition of celebrating Father's Day gradually spread to other countries, including the United Kingdom. However, the holiday did not become an official holiday in the UK until much later. In fact, it wasn't until 1972 that Father's Day was an officially recognised holiday in the UK. These days, it is a day of showing our appreciation to dads through the giving of cards and presents. Today, we want to show our appreciation to all men and to celebrate the goodness and love shown to us by all men who care for us or who are part of our lives. We also want to remember that this goodness comes from God. Now join me with me in the opening prayer.
Heavenly Father, at this special time of year, we pause to give thanks for our dads, grandfathers, uncles, stepfathers, other father figures in our lives. We pray you would guide all children to remember the special men who helped them in their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Psalm will be Psalm 103, verses 30 to 18. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him, for he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of the mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone. And its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting, the Lord's love is with him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenant and remember to obey his precepts.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
The first song is our Father.
She also covered his eyes and the sweet father's neck, the greatest to your son Jacob, it is to think that the rest you have made. He went to his father and said, My father, yes, my son, he answered, He is it. Jacob said to his father, I'm Esau, your firstborn. I've done as you told me. Please sit up and eat some of my game, so that you may give me your blessing. Isaac asked his son, How did you find it so quickly, my son? The Lord of God gave me success here, guys. Then Isaac said to Jacob, Come near, son, and touch me, my son, to know whether you really are my son Esau or not. Jacob went close to his father Isaac. He touched him and said, The voice is the voice of Jacob, but the hands are the hands of Esau. He did not recognize him, for his hands were hairy like those of his brother Esau. So he proceeded to bless him. Are you really my son Esau? He asked. I am, he replied. Then he said, My son, bring me some of the game to eat, so that I may give you my blessing. Jacob brought it to him, and he ate, and he brought some wine, and he drank. Then his father Isaac said to him, Come in, my son, and kiss me. So he went to him and kissed him. When Isaac caught the smell of his clothes, he blessed him and said, Oh, the smell of my son is like the smell of fruit that the Lord has blessed. May God give you heaven to you, and earth richness, and abundance of grain, and new wine. May nations serve you, and people bow down to you. Be Lord of your brothers, and may the sons of your mother bow down to you. May those who curse you be cursed, and those who bless you be blessed. After Isaac finished blessing him, and Jacob backslid, he left his father's presence. His brother Esau came from hunting.
I'll send both of you to by the own account, were not always there for their children, but who continue to offer those children now grown their love and support. As well, let us pray for those fathers who have been wounded by words and actions of their children. Let us praise those fathers who, despite marital discord, have remained in their children's lives. Let us praise those fathers whose children are adopted and whose love and support has natural and living life. Let us pray those fathers as stepfathers bring each other's stuff. Obligation of fatherhood and their step children's love and respect.
Let us praise those fathers who have lost a child to death and continue to hold the child in their heart. Let us praise those men who have no children but cherish the next generation as if they were their own.
As they are such a blessing to us. I pray that you will comfort those who may have lost their father. I acknowledge this by giving us grace. Dear God, I pray that you will bless both fathers and father figures. Amen. In darkness and in light, in trouble and in joy,
help us, Heavenly Father, to trust your love, to serve your purpose, and to praise your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Actually been doing.
you are amazing. That helped me to learn that work for us, that often and kind. You are my dad. I love you. You have been in my life for 7 years. Thank you, Dad. Take care of me. Thank you. Home for my dad. As warm as the sun, as silly as fun, as cool as a tree, as scary as the sea, as bright as the brain, he feels no pain, eyes like fire, touches the fire. Even when he is mad, I still love my dad.
My dad is that he always cheers me up when I'm sad. He is always there to make me laugh. half an hour.
Send the children around to run around. Yeah? Everyone's got one?
No.
We now have intercession of our families.
Let us pray to God, our Heavenly Father, Father of all, hear your children to prayer. Oh dear. Alright, I feel apart because I, for two reasons. One, because I did a assembly at St. James this week, which was on Father's Day, and I thought I'll adapt it to talk this morning. But also because I didn't want to, you know, if I do a PowerPoint, I won't stay too long. If otherwise, I'll leave you already. But I've been so blessed with the children this morning. I am just, it's been a wonderful, absolutely. And we are here. So Father's Day, I don't want to say, and we've said it here many times, and we want to reiterate this, fathers come in all sizes and shapes, don't they? I mean, this is something that we have to continue to reinforce. When we do mothers, we say the same thing. I say to the children at St. James that, you don't have to have children to be a mother. Mother Teresa never had a child. The same thing with fathers. And we need to, get out of this concept that you have to have children to be a father. Fathers and father figures, people in our lives who play the role of father. They could be uncles. I even said to the children, there could be older brothers in some families who play the role of fathers. They are. And so on. So we must get away from this idea that somehow a father must be some sort of biological person, because it's not about the biology of that. That's where we look at it. What are some of the qualities that make a good father? Some of the things that we associate with fatherhood and father being a good father. Alright, so that's a question. Next slide, please. Sorry, you are here. Who's done that? Thank you, Manuel. Thank you for doing this for me. So, some biblical fathers and characters. Now, I'll put that there because, as I was thinking about this, I'm thinking, what are, there's plenty of fathers in the Bible, aren't there? I mean, the Bible was written in a patriarchal society, so a lot more so about men than women. But the fathers, I try to pick out a few. And what I want you to do, in fact, is just to give me a word or a phrase or an expression that you think about when you think of these fathers. I mean, I'm not going to put the microphone around, but just shout it out or put your hand up, or just like I do at school and assembly. Put your hand up, hold on, you're going to get it. So the question is, what do you think of when you think of these people? So let's start with Moses. What comes to your mind as when we hear when we talk about Moses? Okay, Caleb, go ahead.
Messenger.
All right, fine.
Kind.
Maybe. Sue?
Leader.
Okay. Anybody over here? Catherine?
Obedient.
Okay, very good, yes. Hold on, Yes. Caring, maybe, yes.
Upbringing,
all right, fine. Yes, Katie, one more.
Considerate.
All right, considerate. So when you think, yes, Miller.
Sacrificing.
Okay, so when you think of Moses, I mean, each father is different. Some traits would go across all fathers, yes. But some stand out, don't they? We're not all the same. So, can you give me what I have?
Okay.
So I have intimacy with God. The Bible talks about Moses as someone who speaks face to face with God, whatever that means. It's an indication of intimacy. Someone who speaks so close to God, or is so close to God, that the Bible describes him as intimate. Now, we know there are some negative things about Moses as well, don't we? I've only chosen the positive, by the way. It's always good to focus on the positive. It's harder to focus on the positive than the negative. We always say, try to remember some of the good things about a person rather than the negative things. And so, but there are some negative things about Moses. He got angry easily. He was the kind of guy who was easily angry. And yet, paradoxically, he was very patient. If you read any of the books of Moses, you would know he was very patient with those rebellious people. Always in the wilderness. So that's Moses. Let's move on to Abraham. Now, but before you bring it up, what comes to your mind when you think of Abraham, do you know? Patient, yes sir.
A father of many children,
very good actually. A father of many children. Anybody else?
Great faith.
Someone with great faith. Oh, put mine up, because we're going to be all day. Faith, obedience, patience. Faith, of course, is what you hear when you think of Abraham. Obedience to God. God said to Abraham, I want you to sacrifice your son to me. That is a tall order for any father. And Abraham, okay, says, we're. obedience to God. And great patience. Johnny, what is it?
Faith one is really, really important. Yes. Faith of Abraham. Also the father of many nations.
Yes.
As well as.
Yes, but as well as the patience, because at the age of 90, God promised him a son. And that son never came for another 10 years. So there is that. Joshua, what do you think of what you we are studying Joshua. In fact, in the readings, I think in the morning or evening prayer, was Joshua. I think we just finished reading Joshua. And we are doing Joshua in our Bible study. What do you think of when you hear in Joshua? Put your hand up there. Leah. He's young. Yes, that's a good point actually. He was a young leader. He was young when God chose him. Yes, son.
Fearless.
And you said another word before, wasn't it? Courageous. Yes. Courageous. Two.
Jericho.
Yes. A journey.
Brave.
So, put my courage. Strong military leader. Joshua was the military leader, the one who conquered and fought against God's enemies in the land. He was primarily called for that purpose, and he was a young man as well. Yes. All right, David. Yes. Fearless and courageous. All right, that's good. David. When you think of David, you think of someone that fearless and courageous. I see Janelle, right? King. Okay, yes, he was a king. He was a king, yes.
Great worshipper of God,
yes.
Imperfect.
Very good, actually. Very important, Father. Just an imperfect Father. Yes, King.
A leader,
yes. Yes, comfort. Great warrior as well. Just like Joshua, by the way. Great warrior.
David was brave.
Put mine up. I said, a fearless singer, a worshiper, honest self examination. Yes, remember when he did all these terrible things. And the prophet came to him and said, you are the sinner. You're the one who's been sinning, who's sinned against God. And he prayed, he wrote that great confession, Psalm 51, have mercy on me, O God, and so on and so forth. John.
He really struggled with his family relationship.
Yes.
Between the siblings.
Yes.
So the brothers, they killed each other and there were battles and he had to try and sort all that out and then they attacked him again.
Yes, absolutely.
He had a difficult family relationship.
He did. In fact, there's another one that does that at the point. But yes, he had a difficult family relationship. He was the youngest of seven brothers. And they all looked down at him as if he's some sort of,
Well, I think of Goliath as well.
Goliath? Yes, he killed Goliath, yes. Yes, which is one of his great achievements, absolutely. And he did that when he was a young man, he was probably only a teenager. But because he was fearless, when everybody else is cowering, he stood up. Yes, yes. All right, moving on. Joseph, Old Testament Joseph. There are two Josephs, the New Testament and the Old Testament. Let's think of the Old Testament Joseph. Yes.
A good father,
but why, yes? No, that was David.
He was
Yes.
He still persevered in the
kingdom. He persevered, yes. Alright. Anyone over there? Yeah? Oh no, I thought I saw a hand over there. Oh yes, yeah.
Ruler.
Okay, he was a ruler. Yes. David.
A dreamer.
Now that's a good one actually. He was a dreamer. Well, let me describe someone as a dreamer today. That's not what really matters with Joseph. But it's a good word for Joseph. A dreamer. Alright, let's move on. Forgiveness, statesman, and someone who had very, very difficult sibling rivalry. 12 brothers, sold him into slavery, wanted to kill him, all the rest, you know the story. But the thing that, remember I said, what is it that comes out, actually? The thing that comes out of remorse in prison is his forgiveness. At the very end of the story, when he forgave his brothers for doing those terrible things against him. Now, it takes great courage and strength to be able to do that. To the brothers who sold you into slavery, wanted you dead, and did everything in their power to kill you or to get rid of you, and in the end, he forgave them all for all that. One last Joseph. I will just take one or two if anybody has. This is Joseph. Yes.
Loyal.
Very good one. Very good. I think we know what Joseph. Deborah.
Protector.
Very good. Caleb.
He was a soldier.
He wasn't actually. That's the thing. He wasn't. This is a different Joseph. Yeah, judging. Huh?
Guiding.
All right. Anybody else? One more? No? Alright, this Joseph is of course the husband of Mary, the mother of our Lord. And he was obedient to God, and faithfulness and commitment. Somebody says loyal, commitment to his wife. If you know the story, it takes another great courage to take on that role that Joseph took on. His wife became pregnant with his child, and he had to be convinced by an angel that this was God's will. And as a result of that, became loyal and faithful and committed to his wife and his child, who was not his child, which is important. The son was not his, but he looked after him, cared for him, and brought him up. That son, of course, is Jesus. So that's Joseph. Very important. All right, moving forward, quickly. So some of the qualities of what I call a godly father. Let's put up the next one. Fears God. These are some of the qualities of some of those people, and of course, the scripture. Fears God, loving, forgiving, caring, compassionate, honest, truthful, and etc. Because the list will go on. These are qualities, not just that they're good father, is what I said at St. James this week, but qualities of a godly father. Qualities of someone who follows God. And the first one here is that they fear God. They reverence God. They put God first in their lives. Another, next slide, please. Alright, so Jesus taught us, as we say here, to call God our Father. In fact, he gave us a prayer. That prayer begins, Our Father in Heaven. And of course, whenever I talk on the Lord's Prayer, I like to make the point that the expression, Our Father in Heaven, is not simply giving us the location of God. You know, God is in heaven. It's actually a description of who, of the type of Father God is. He's our heavenly Father, as opposed to our earthly Father. Now, we have earthly fathers, but God is not an earthly Father. God is a heavenly Father, which means there are certain qualities about God that are very different from the qualities that you may find in an earthly father. And so it's actually the quality is perfection. A heavenly father is our perfect father. Now, it's important that we reflect on that because none of our fathers were perfect. I know we wish them. And we pray that they be, but they were not, and they are not. Not even me, as so none of our fathers are perfect. But we do have a perfect Father. And that's what Jesus taught us to say. God, our Father, the one, the Heavenly Father, is our perfect Father. So he's loving, caring, he's a perfect Father, he never fails. And God is a perfect model of what fatherhood means. So let's go to the next slide, because that explains a little bit more. Jesus says in Matthew 5, verse 48, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. And this is the point. And that's why he's our heavenly Father, because he is a perfect Father. Now, Jesus then calls us to be perfect. Now, what does it mean? We always have this. People always wonder about this. What is this perfection? Jesus is calling us to be perfect. Now, let me just say that it's the highest quality that you could ever get. Whatever it is, it's not something that we have naturally. It's something that God has. And Jesus is calling us to draw on that from God. The first thing to say, though, it is that it's not moral perfection. This is not that God is perfectly good and so on. That is not, you know, someone who keeps the law perfectly. That is not what this is. Now, that's one form of perfection. And usually when we think of perfection, we are thinking of someone who is morally upright. Someone who walks a straight and narrow way, who never goes off to the right or the left, someone who is perfect in their morality and in their way of life. Now, that's not what this is, but that's fine, and that's a good thing as well. That's not what this word perfect is. And I'd like to put the Greek word there, because it's a good word to know. The Greek word is telos. And it doesn't mean moral perfection, it means wholeness, completion, fullness. In fact, it's sometimes translated in the New Testament as mature, or even someone who is full of integrity. It's a great word, integrity. Someone who is whole, that's what the word integrity means, comes from the word integer. Which means whole. Integers are whole numbers in math. I'm looking at it if we should know. But, integrity. Someone, so I'll put some things up there. Be well rounded, be whole, be complete as God is complete. God does not say one thing and does another. He doesn't say, he's not one thing in private and another thing in public. You see, he's whole. He's together. God can be counted on by everyone at all times. God is complete. God does not pretend. He doesn't pretend. And this is what perfection is. When Jesus says, be perfect, he's saying, be like God in being whole, being complete. So God is sincere, he's whole, he's wholehearted, and we should be like him. So that is the quality that Jesus is saying we should have like God. Again, it's not about morality. It's not saying I tick all the boxes and I follow all the rules. No. This is about, are you whole? Are you the same with one crowd as you are with the other crowd? Or do you change to fit the situation, the circumstances? God does not change. James says God is not like shifting sand. He is constant. He's the same. Alright? So that's perfection. Next one, please. I've got my time. Advice to fathers. A few advice. There are lots of advices that the scripture gives to fathers, yes? I just took those two because I think they sum everything. So, first of all, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in discipline and instruction of the Lord. So this one is Paul saying, fathers, don't provoke your children. Care for them, look after them, love them, of course, but bring them up right. You know, so there's another version that I'm going to put there is train a child in the way he should go on when he's older and not depart from it. It's not just for father, of course, for mother as well, but it's for the whole family, really. Is that we should be the kind of fathers who invest spiritual time and effort in our children. And so bring them up in discipline. Discipline is one of those words that goes with being a father. Even God says he disciplines his children because he loves them. And last one, Joshua 24, because Joshua was on my mind this week, we were reading Joshua in the praise, and this verse comes. Stands out. Joshua said, "As for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord." It's a fatherly decision. In my house, we will serve the Lord. He said, "You can do whatever you want to do, but as for my house and my family, we are going to serve the Lord." So that's a fatherly stance. Next slide, please. So this last bit is a story of a father. You know the story, that's why I didn't bother to go over it. It's a story, we call it the story of the prodigal son. But it's really not a story about the prodigal son at all. It's a story about a loving and believing father. That's really what the story is about. The son goes away, goes astray, does all he could to, you know, disgrace his father, then comes back home groveling after years of, you know, disrespect. Now the father can go over things. The father can say, "How dare you come?" We heard so many fatherly things already this morning. You know, where are you coming from? You're not coming through my door. You know, that sort of thing. But now Jesus says, and of course, the Father is God. Jesus says the Father runs. The Father sees the Son from a distance. He's dirty, he's smelly, he doesn't look right. He's probably, you know, unshaven and all that. But the Father recognizes his Son. And he runs after the Son. And which in itself was not something that those men do. Because as you can see in the picture, I chose a picture because it has this long flowing robe, and so in order to run, you have to literally pick up the robe and run. And saints, fathers don't do that sort of thing in the ancient world. So he runs, filled with compassion, hugged his son, kissed him, and brought him back into the family. A forgiving father. And Jesus is teaching us the story because he's saying that is the kind of father that we are to be. That's the kind of father God is, first, and that's the kind of father that we are called to be. Forgiving, loving, caring, someone who brings in the wayward. So we're going to pray. There's a prayer that I put up there. I'm going to pray that prayer, it's meditation, actually. You know, it's something to just as that you have even single parents who fulfill both roles. You know, when my wife passed away, I was mother and father. So a mother's dead and a card. I did. Of course I did. Why wouldn't I? Because I was mother and father. So yeah, so just, you know, let's not eliminate these things. It's the qualities that matter, not the gender. Okay. All right, so let's pray. This first prayer, and I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to ask the Father, Sister. Heavenly Father, God, thank you for fathers and all those who fulfill the role of fathers in our lives. Help them to be like you, to love, to care, and to show compassion as you do for us, your children. Protect all fathers and guide them to be the best they can be for their children. Amen. So we'll ask fathers to stand, and I'm going to pray for you. So Father, we thank you that you are the perfect Father, that you've called us to model you, to imitate you. So Lord, we pray for all fathers, all those who are fathers biologically, but those who father families, children, who are uncles, who are grandfathers, and who are fathers in the church, who may not necessarily have any children of their own, but they have the quality of a father. And so Lord, we pray for them. We pray for all the fathers. We pray for your blessing upon them this Father's Day. And we ask, O God, that you will strengthen them in their role as they seek to model you, to imitate you, as fathers to their children, to other children, and to the children of our church. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be taken. See you when we sing a song. Yes and amen. Okay. I think it's on YouTube. Is the word saying? Are the words on the screen? Let's stand. morning, afternoon now, exactly 12 o'clock. We want to look at some birthdays and thank. And then we have another song, yes? There's a fire song. I didn't know that yet. Well, are there birthdays? Let's start with birthdays. See Catherine Chan?
It's
Noah. Noah's birthday. Noah's birthday. All right, Noah. All right, it's great. We're going to say happy birthday to you, Noah. Anybody else's birthday this week?
Yes, you too.
it's
my
birthday.
Yes. This week, on Friday, is going to be my birthday. And the family's birthday on Friday. Yes. Thank you, Zulita and Maxine. Any other birthdays this week? No? All right, let's have a stand up, the penny stand up. You can represent both of us. We're going to sing happy birthday to you guys. Come on. Stand up. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. But she said I should ask you
to guess who these people are. They are people who are in our service today. If you already know, don't put your hand up. But if you don't know, who are these people? It's a silhouette of two people here. Can you put your hand up, because I don't know. Anybody? Hold on, I see you now. No, it's not Emmanuel. Yes, it's not Emmanuel. Very good. At the back, okay.
I think
Pauline.
Maya and her dad.
Sorry?
Maya and her dad.
Maya and her dad. There they are. Stand up, you see. Maya and her dad. That's absolutely wonderful. Oh my goodness. I'm like, it's interesting. There's some artists around here as well, so amazing. Alright, so thank you. Alright, some other things. Mark, my two friends from Home Church are here. It's great to see them. Mark and Leslie, do stand up. It's great to see Mark and Leslie coming to share our Father's Day service with us. Leslie used to pick up Nathaniel from school and keep him until I do a funeral or something and come back. So it's great to have you guys from the whole church joining us this morning. Do say that a moment to yourself and we can talk more, yeah? And also, I'm pretty sure I have. Well, Fula is here, but Fula was here. I think she's there. Fula comes, she's now a regular, so she is no longer just. I have another person. Cynthia, there's Cynthia, yes. Friend of Jennifer's. She's been here before, but it's good to have you again. And it's good to see Veronica, God bless you, so wonderful. God bless you. God bless you. Yes, that's all, Catherine. Oh, yes, your friends, tell us about them.
Hello.
Hello. Vasella and
Lazarus.
Lazarus. Alright, Very good. It's good to have you guys. Alright. Few other notices quickly. The day trip to Great Yarmouth is on the 1st of July. Hopefully if you have the £25, Jenny will start taking that from you today. That'll be great. Dina Simmons is on for the Simmons people this week at St. Mark's Church. So two things. One is, I'm going to be away this week, and I also would love to see PCC right after, very, very quickly, not very long, just a very brief meeting. I just have a few things to mention. I'm away this week at a conference in Amsterdam. And it's called Empower 21. You can I'll put the website there. You can have a look at it. I'll be away from Tuesday until Friday. I'll be back on Friday, so I'll be back for Sunday. Do pray for me as I join this conference. It's something that is an amazing conference, and I'm looking forward to it. There is a note here that I pulled from Dave Martins. Dave, if you've received any email from David saying to send money because he's in the hospital, who has not received those emails? It's of course a fake and a scam, so don't try to send David the money, please, okay? It's somebody who has hacked into his email and is doing nothing. And just to say, be vigilant about this. If you get those emails from anybody, call them first. Okay, and say, what's going on? What is this idea? Rather rather than actually studying one, because there's so many evil people out there trying to scam me. Alright. You are an alternative now. Okay, that's fine. Alright, so we're going to follow you. Alright, that's great. Okay, I want Catherine, come. Hello, yes. Now, Catherine, there is a card going around. I don't know if everybody has signed it. I have sent it around. But, you know, we should have had it last week, shouldn't we? But she's going to explain something, so I'll give you the floor for the moment, but then we're going to thank you for being here.
If you haven't signed the card, I still have it, so let me know, and I'll bring it to you. You go ahead. Yes, do you go ahead, explain.
First of all, I just want to say thank you to all the children and all the teachers that did such an amazing job today. Shall we say well done, one more time? And bless you, the brothers. Yeah, it was a global community survey, and I promised to tell you, so obviously it's to do with my college, to do with my school. It's done, but I promised to give you the results. So, it was to do with members of the church, your attitude towards evangelism, right? And many people would agree evangelism is a good thing, it should be done, but sometimes they don't personally practice that, they don't do it. And we were looking for the reasons, because there could be many reasons. For example, lack of confidence, different levels of interest, too much effort and time, probably, and also some people just don't feel this is necessary at all. It's just different beliefs. Of course, many acknowledge Jesus as their Savior and Lord. Many feel responsible to spread the good news that comes from the story of Jesus. And of course, the Bible tells us that the hearts is plentiful, but the word is a few. So our current study that 37, thank you so much, 37 people filled in, shows that the majority of people who took part in the study importance of personal evangelism, they are willing and interested and want to take part in further training, further training, something like evangelism course, if it's made available in church. So we're just going to go through the questions one by one. The first one is pretty obvious. We can skip the first one. You guys confirmed that you read the information. The second one is just talking about the ages of people who filled it in. So it's really, I don't know who you are, but I know your ages, right? So we got the biggest sample coming from the groups with ages between 50 and 79, where the biggest group was, as you can see, the age 60 to 69, with 11 people. And 8 people in each 50 to 59 and 7 to 79. 6 people in the 30 to 39 group and 2 people in each group, so 18 to 29 and 40 to 49. We're going to go to question 3. So, all of you guys who feel that they indicated that you're in church every day. So, 37 of you said you're in church weekly, every Sunday. Question 4. Ask, what does it mean to you to share the gospel with others? So you had 4 different choices. 3 different choices? 30 people, 30 out of 37 answered that it means all 3 of the listed, which was to tell people about who Jesus is, to be good and show Jesus through what we do, and finally, to invite people to church. That's 30 of you, so well done. That's 81% of people that said all the above. 3. 4 people indicated that sharing the gospel with others means being good to people and show Jesus, which is great. And 3 people said, sharing the gospel with others means that we must simply tell people about who Jesus is. So yes, according to these results, a big majority of people understood the evangelism involves all the things above, which is to tell Jesus, to show Jesus, and also invite people to church. It is part of it. Question number five. Yes, when they ask if they shared the good news, the gospel with anyone in the last 1 year, 35 people said yes. So well done. Only two people said no. Question six, when asking if they answered yes to sharing the gospel, how many people? These results are amazing. These results are just brilliant. So 40 people said 1 to 3 people. 10 people said more than 10 people. 7 people answered 64. And 4 people answered between 7 and 10. So this is just well done to you guys. You have been shared. Then those results indicate that people do consistently share the gospel in one way or another and talk about their faith in ways. This, of course, does not necessarily mean people will invite people back to church, but some people do not. But you share the good news, which is amazing. From those, the majority people, which is 25 people, said yes, they invited people to church, and 11 said they did not invite people to church. Question 8, when asked how confident, when I asked how confident you guys felt about the ability to evangelize, 18 people went for somewhat confident. I think we all kind of there. To be honest, that would be very scary to say. We thought I should be able to say I'm really confident. But 18 people said somewhat confident. 7 people said they're very confident. 6 people said they're extremely confident. Well done, guys. Well done, honestly. And 4 people said not so confident. 2 people said not at all confident. Well done. Thank you for being honest. Yes, So 6 people have indicated that they are not so confident in their ability to share the gospel altogether. 13 people consider themselves pretty confident. And almost half of the people, like I said, 18 people share the deal with someone confident. Those are pretty good figures, but they deserve some attention. As much as those that are not confident, there are clearly things that are on the way of holding people back. Like I said, for example, they could be people think, oh, I don't have enough knowledge, I need to have a theological degree to feel. So even if you have a theological degree, you could feel not confident at all, just saying that. But it could be many reasons that stop us from feeling confident to evangelize. So it's good to explore those and obviously address them. Question 9. When asked to indicate their level of interest in terms of available evangelism courses, the majority of you, so which is 25 people out of 37, answered extremely and very interested of this kind of course being available, and 8 people said they are somewhat interested. Altogether, that's 33 out of 37 people want to know more about evangelism course, Reverend Henry. They people indicated not too interested, and only one person not at all interested, so we had 4. So these above results, question 10, we're considering do this. So ask, would you like such course to be available? Those 33 people say yes, which is same as the other question 9, and 4 people said no, which is the same as question 9. All this tells the majority of people who took part, understand the importance of personal evangelism, are willing to do it, are interested, they want to take part in further training, evangelism course, if they are made available in the church. This can further support and aid those that don't feel that confident, those 18 people that said we're not so confident, So that's in the other bits there, so 25 people in total not feeling so confident. For those who feel confident, it could serve as a further aid to refresh knowledge. This will support people with the ability to hold shared gospel and be brave enough to invite people to church. As you know, people indicated they did not feel confident enough to invite people to church. If we take away the four that don't really believe they should do this, that's at least seven people who can benefit from something that will make them confident to how to invite people maybe in church. 33 out of 35 who indicated they share the gospel said that they're extremely interested in learning more about it. They should be part of evangelism, of course, in the church. So well done.
Presence with Reverend
God safely to us. I will enjoy the conference. Keep them safe and protected, and continue to spread good news, as Catherine told us, that the congregation did a very good job. And so we commend them into your care for the future and all their future endeavors. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
All right, we are going to have a final song, because I'm way overdue. As I said, just before we go, just to leave the pieces to the altar, let's stand. I think you guys want to explain, or I'll just, yeah, go on.
Okay, this song, it's called There's No One Like Jesus. We're going to listen to the YouTube version, and there are actions to this song. So it's very slow, we're trying to do the actions. So if you want to join in, feel free. But happy Father's Day to everyone, and yeah, enjoy. Thank you.
we have in Jesus. We thank you that you are our great Father, and you have us. And so, Lord, we entrust our week to you, we entrust our lives to you as our Father who cares. And you bless all fathers and all families here, that we will show your care, your love, to those who are significant in our lives, in our church, and in our community. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. To let the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you, remain with you and all you love today, this week, and forever. Amen. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.